tea ready, and just let's love on God this morning. So this morning, I just want to pray with you and just thank God for you. Let me just get my notes pulled up here and for you, and let's get right into the Word of God. So I'm just so thankful this morning for you. Father, we just thank you for all that you are doing, all that your hands have done. We just bless you this morning because you are the Alpha and the Omega. You are the beginning and the end. You are the bright and morning star. We thank you this morning because you cause us to triumph over every circumstance, over every obstacle that comes our way, oh God. Lord, you just cause us to be able to consider our calling this morning and just to continue to do that which you have called us to do. So God, I ask right now that as I break open this word, as you let your Holy Spirit come and fill the room, fill on the people on Facebook, fill the people who will watch via YouTube or social media after this broadcast has been recorded, God. Lord, I'm asking right now that you would just continue to just pour into us, pour into our faith, pour into our wisdom, pour into our love this morning, God. We are asking right now for you to just be with us this morning, be in us this morning, and just continue to do that. And Lord, Holy Spirit, speak. Have your way this morning. Have your way this morning. We bless you and we thank you in the name of Christ Jesus. We pray and give thanks. Amen and amen. Good morning to everybody who is watching this morning. I am so thankful for God just doing what he wants to do. And so let me just woosah this morning. This is the first Sunday of February. If you have not picked a church, or if you don't have a church home to go to, Lord, I'm just asking right now that you would just touch your people, let them find a place to be in fellowship this morning. Even if it's not at our fellowship, if it's not at my congregation, God, Lord, allow them to find somewhere to find fellowship and find communion with you this morning, true and authentic fellowship this morning. If you are in the Rochester area and you would like to join me this morning for communion or join me this morning for a word from God, we are located at New Horizon Faith Center, 910 A Genesee Street in Rochester, New York. That's in 14611, where Reverend Patrick Cromedy is our associate pastor. And then if you always want to join us online, I will be starting a new ministry called The Pillar, and we will be moving across with the people. So we will be moving and moving with God's people as the pillar of fire and the cloud of pillar move with the people in the wilderness. So we just want to thank God for each and every one of you that is tuning in. So consider your call. I'm coming from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and I wanted to focus more on verses 25 or 26 through 31. And I'll just go ahead and talk a little bit about this. What Paul is talking about in the first couple of verses, which is, can everybody hear me okay? Can you give me like a thumbs up or a like if you can hear me okay? Just to let me see what's going on. But what Paul is, I think you can, thank you. What Paul is talking about in this particular text is he's talking about how the testimony of the believers of God seems foolish to those who consider themselves to be as wise. And so we understand that, oh God, thank you. Thank you for your Holy Spirit this morning. So there are so many different ways that the world has a philosophy. It has a philosophy of how we should think, how we should act, how we should speak, and how we should have such intellect. And there are so many people that, you know, we as believers, we as children of God, even me with my doctorate degrees and all of these different degrees and letters behind my name, even me, you know, it's expected of me to be a certain type of way. It's expected of me to be able to speak with our, you know, appropriate articulation. It's expected of me to be able to, and so they say, well, because you are people of God, and this is what Paul was a great preacher. He was a great orator, and he would be able to get into these debates, into these competitions with other philosophers. But see, you got to remember, this is the philosophy of the world. And so Paul is saying that the gospel is foolishness to the philosophy of the world. The way that we conduct ourselves as Christian believers, as children of God, it seems like foolishness to the way of the world. The morals and the standards that we set ourselves with, it seems like it is foolishness to the people of the world. And so he's saying that even God will use the foolish things, the things that the world calls foolish, to confound the wise. They will see that the way of God is better. The way of God brings more peace. It brings more joy. It brings more happiness. It brings more satisfaction to life. When you do things the way that God wants us to do things, the way that the world wants us to do things, it will bring us destruction. We're always looking for gain. We're always looking to get ahead. We're always, if you do things the way that the world wants us to do things, if we enter into that competition the way that the world wants us to enter into competition to get the pleasures of this present time, we will get ourselves a fool's gold theology. Come on, y'all. We will end up with a serving a God that does not satisfy all of our needs, when the Bible distinctly says that God, my God, will supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory. And so we have to make sure that we understand that to worship God, to praise God, and it seems foolishness because we praise something that the philosophers and that the psychologists, they say that we cannot see, but we can see God because we look back over our lives and we see how God has brought us over, how God has kept our minds, how God has kept us in the midst of the times of storms, how God has brought us through trials and temptations. When we begin to look at those things, when we begin to consider those things, we begin to see the call on our lives. And so when we begin to consider the call of God on our lives, it does not take the same form and the same fashion that the world wants us to have. It does not take the same philosophy that the world has. It takes a transferring and a renewing of our minds. It takes considering our call. It takes a transferring and a renewing to look at things in a different perspective. It takes a transferring and a call on our minds to look at things through the lens of God. And so when we see the call on our lives, we begin to see that God has brought us through so much, and it's not the way that the scribes, it's not the way that the secular institutions want us to say it. We share the gospel of God. We share the gospel of Jesus Christ, who was crucified and died for our sins, for whatever was going on in our lives, whatever is ailing us in our lives, whatever it is. Jesus, who is our Christ, who is our King, not the president, not the ambassador, not the whoever over the United Nations. We're talking about the mind of Christ is Lord over our lives. The word of God is Lord over our lives. The truth of God is Lord over our lives. And that is our call. Our call, regardless to anything, whether you're called to be a bishop, a teacher, a preacher, an apostle, whatever the fivefold ministry gifts are, whatever they are, you are called to testify to God's grace. You are called to testify to God's truth, and you have to consider that call in every day of your life. It says that he gives us new mercies every day, new mercies every day. And so every day we have a decision. We have a decision to make. We have a decision to be able to wake up and rise up and be able to talk about the goodness of Jesus. And so let me go to this scripture. He says, for you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. Your calling is distinguished. Let me just tell you that. Somebody help me out. Shelquan, thank you for tuning in. Somebody help me out. Put down distinguished call. It's a distinguished call. It's my call. Just put my call, my call. It's a personal call. It's something that God has called you to specifically. And so one thing that you have to know that not many are called to your calling. Sometimes I used to think, I was like, doesn't everybody get this? Doesn't everybody do this? Doesn't everybody? And no, that everybody does not do what you do. Everybody cannot do what God has called you to do. And so verse 27, he says, but God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things that are mighty. People who think that they have power over us, people who think that they have prestige, people who think that they have so much wisdom and they know so much and they know so much more than you. Here's the thing, humility, staying low. You know, somebody said, get low, get low. Humility is what confounds the people who are prideful. They can't understand why we get so low. And so I love it. I love it because it says, get low, get low. And so when we get low, we get quiet. We get that peace. We get that place where we begin to come into the things of God. And people who think that they are wise, people who think that they are strong, people who think that they are mighty, they can't understand why the people of God continue to triumph over and out. Why aren't we shaken? Why aren't we, why, God bless you, Apostle. Why aren't we shaken? Why aren't we stirred? Why aren't we disrupted or disturbed by the things that are going on in the way of the world? And they wonder why we are that way, because God has used some of the things that the world calls weak and some of the things that the world calls foolish to confound them. And they start to focus in on why the people of God are not being moved today, because we understand that God's hand is in everything. Come on, people of God. Come on, people of God. And so he says he puts those things to shame. And then here's verse 28. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised, God has chosen. God has chosen. Those things that seem to be the lowest. That's what I'm trying to tell you, people of God. Get low. Get low. Let me tell you something. When I was in the military and we used to be in the foxhole and we used to have to shoot at and be a sharp shooter or a sniper, and we had to shoot at the target, and sometimes they would tell us we would have to get out, and so we would have to get down on the ground, and we would have to climb with our weapons in our hand, and we would have to move, and we were down on the ground. That because everything, hey, God, I feel it. Somebody need to get low, because everything that the devil is shooting at you, it might catch my hair, Andre Clark, but it won't catch my mind. And so, and so it'll just bypass over you. People will have to shoot low to be able to hit you. Come on, you gotta get low. Get low. And getting low is a posture of humility, and it's a posture of prayer, people of God. Amen. And so he says that the things that are low, the things that are despised, is what God has chosen. He has chosen the disinherited. He has chosen the marginalized. He has chosen the ones that are not in the 1%. God has chosen the 99, and that was for somebody. That was for somebody. And so he says that no flesh, He says that God has chosen, and the things that are not to bring to nothing are the things that are. And so he says the things that are not to, that are not counted, that haven't been counted. We are the ones, since we're not in that number. Come on, since we're not in that number, that other number, you know, that number that where people are being counted, that 1%. Since we're not in that number, then God will take the 99% of the population that will get low, that will serve him. He will bring the remnant out of that place, and he will give them the inheritance. We are the ones that are going to put in the work, people of God, but we cannot compromise. We cannot compromise the truth of God's word and the gospel that lives in us for the foolishness of this world. Come on, for the wisdom of this world. Some of us are trying to attain more to be accepted by the world, when God says not so. You are accepted for more than the world, dear. You are accepted in the kingdom. Come on, be accepted and approved. And I'll talk about that next week. And so, or maybe for Bible study this week. If you'd like to tune in to Bible study and you'd like me to do a Bible study, please put Bible study in the hashtag, and I will be able to respond to that. But to him, here it is in verse 29, that no flesh should glory in his presence. We have to be careful in our sanctuaries, people of God. And I think this is for the worship leaders. I believe that this is for the people who lead worship, the people who preach worship, all of us who serve the church directly in some type of form or fashion. Anyone who serves the church, we have to be very careful not to exalt ourselves in his presence. He says that no flesh shall glory in his presence. No flesh. And so that means that we have to consider our call. Our call is is to preach the gospel. Our call is to get low. Our call is to be able to confound and to get into and to make the wisdom of this world seem as though it is foolishness, because we tell the truth about what God, and people cannot understand how God brought us through so many different trials and tribulations. And so the thing about it is, he says that we have to be careful that our flesh does not glory in the presence of God. Here's the thing, and this is a verse all by itself. If you have your Bible, I'm reading from the New King James Version. If you have your Bible, it says that no flesh shall glory in the presence of God. And my commentary says, God's purpose in doing this is to prevent any boasting in secular status. That means we do not bring, no matter what type of doctor, reverend, psalmist, whatever you are, in the presence of God, you are a servant of God, you are a child of God, and in the presence of God, you should not boast in whatever secular, now that's what qualifies you in certain arenas to be able to go into certain arenas, but all the glory belongs to God. Because if you really talk about it, if it had not been for the Lord on your side, where would you be today? Would you have all of that stuff? No. So we give all the glory to God in that manner. So here it is. And then verse 30, he says, but of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom for God. So when we saturate ourselves with the mind of Christ, we inherit the wisdom of God. Y'all still with me? And so he says he became in righteousness and sanctification and redemption. These are the three things that confound. They don't understand. The world doesn't understand how we can be counted, even with our nasty selves, how we can still be counted as righteous. Because here's why it is, and thank you again, we do not allow the flesh to boast. We do not allow the flesh to boast in the glory of God. We must, I cannot emphasize this enough as I'm getting ready to go into my church on this morning. We cannot let the flesh get in the way of God's glory. All right. And so he says, because, but of him, you are in Christ Jesus. And he became wisdom from God for us. He showed us how the wisdom of God works, and righteousness, how that works, and how sanctification works, and how redemption works. And so now we understand that we are called to this, and we are called to do the same thing that Christ Jesus did. We are called to be that wisdom for somebody else of God. That wisdom from God. We are called to be that righteousness of God for somebody. We are called to show that sanctification. We are witnesses to the way that God sanctifies us. We are witnesses to the way that God redeems us. And so we have to be that. And in verse 31, it says that it is, as it is written, he who glorifies, here it is, let him glory in the Lord. This is your call. No matter whether you're called to a high office or whether you're called to just be in the presence of God, your job, your call on every level of everything that you do for the kingdom of God is, here it is, he who glorifies, let him glory in the Lord. We have to make it. Here it is, because the world will tell us that we have to glorify ourselves and we have to bring ourselves up. But no, he who glorifies, let him glory in the Lord, because that is where we get our power. That is where we draw our energy. He says that all, he says, according, he will supply all of, I said this earlier, all of our needs according to his riches in glory. And so we must start our day, start our activities, start our church services glorifying the Lord. We must glorify. It does not matter where you are, how many PhDs you have. It doesn't matter how many titles you have. It doesn't matter. Your call is to glorify the Lord. And so I just want you to just make a practice of glorifying God in everything that you do, because Bible says that life in depth is in the power of your tongue. And so what we have to do is we have to make it a habit to glorify God with all of our activities. Glorify God with all of our being. He says, in him we move and live and have our being. It is in him that we have life, and that life was the light of men. It is in the life of Christ Jesus that we are resurrected and we are revived. It is in him, and that we give God the glory this morning. Lord, we bless you this morning. We testify to your grace. We consider that we are called to you, that it was you that chose us, you that called us. It wasn't us that came to you, but it was you that, he says, I have chosen you. And so he chose you to glorify him, to be a testimony, to be a witness that God is still a healer, God is still a deliverer, God is still a provider, God is a bridge over troubled waters. I feel my help, that God allows his Holy Spirit to come and rest and rule and provide for us. And it also gives us comfort in the midst of every storm. It gives us sleep with sleepless nights. When I promise you, there is somebody who is suffering right now from insomnia, and you have worry, you have stress, you have so much going on in your mind. But I challenge you today to glorify God, to begin to thank God, to begin to do like the scriptures. He says he makes the unseen things seen unto those. He says, and here's another part of the Bible where it says that we have the power to speak those things that are not as though they already are. Begin to speak with me. I'm speaking right now over your life, that all stress and anxiety over your bills is removed, that all stress and anxiety over your financial situation is being removed, that God is going to be that you are going to be the lender and not the borrower, that you are going to be above only and not beneath, that God is going to make a way in the wilderness as he has made ways for you before. God is getting ready to make a way for you. Glorify God and thank him for making a way. You don't have to know how he's going to do it, because your intellect and your PhD and your master's degree, associate's degree, bachelor's degree status, how long you've been in the church, is not going to, he says, he uses the foolish things to confound the wise. He says, my ways are not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts. And so the Lord says, he says that you are not going to be able to figure him out, but you need to trust him where you cannot trace him. So even if you start out in glorifying God by saying, I trust you, Lord. I trust you. Somebody just hashtag that. Those of you who are still with me, those of you who are getting ready to face some obstacles, those of you who are coming out of obstacles, if you just came out of something, someone needs to see that you trust the Lord, and just somebody put in the hashtag, I trust you, Lord. I trust the God of miracles. I trust the God that wakes me up every day, that wakes me up every morning and gives me strength. Whatever type of strength that you have, glorify God in that. I'm going to let you guys go now, but my challenge for you today, as you go to your fellowships, as you go to your churches, as you go wherever you're going, my challenge for you today is start off by inviting the presence of God, inviting the glory of God. Do not make church a task today. Do not make church a task today. Don't make it a thing. Make it a joy. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I was glad to go in and give God glory. And how about this? Even if you give God glory, there may be someone who's going through something that will see you giving God the glory, and it becomes contagious. Let the glory of God become contagious in the house of God today. This is my prayer for you. I hope that this has helped someone. I pray that you have been recharged this morning. I pray that you are charged up this morning. Once again, if you do not have a church home and you would like to come and fellowship with us this morning, if you would like to come and receive communion this morning, if you are a believer of God and you have if you've been out of fellowship and you would like to come visit us today, our service starts this morning at 10 o'clock. Today is the second of February. It is the first Sunday in February of 2020. And we start at 10 o'clock. We go from 10 o'clock to about 11:15. So don't be late. And we start at 10 o'clock. So the address is 910 A Genesee Street, 910 A Genesee Street. Come on out, fellowship with us this morning. And also this Monday, if you are in the area, we will be doing Pastors on Point, and I will put up more information on the description, but I believe we're going to be praying for the economic stability. So if you need prayer over your finances, if you need prayer over your economic stability, I will be participating in that prayer with other pastors from the city. And so I will put up a flyer. Please stay tuned to my Facebook, my Instagram, wherever this broadcast is going on. And if you would like to keep in touch with me, please go online and visit my website and subscribe to the blog page. It is drdjrobinson.com, drdjrobinson.com, or you can go to redeemingcrowns.com, whichever one, it'll take you to the same page. And that will be a help for me to be able to keep in touch with you. So I love each and every one of you. I pray that you have been recharged. I pray that this helps someone. And please today, give God all the glory. That is your call. In Jesus' name, amen.